Thanks, John, and good morning, everyone, and thank you for your patience. As you saw earlier, we are going to have one of our panelists will be appearing via Zoom remotely, and in our defense, we only had 3 years to learn that technology, so how can we be expected to do it smoothly today? But we're very excited to bring this panel to you today. For those of you that don't know, there have been a lot of conversations over the last couple of days and several references to the National Registry of Exonerations. I think most people in this room are probably familiar with that registry. The registry was founded in 1980. What was the founding date?
We went live in 2012.
Live in 2012. And it has had a number of iterations over the years as different kinds of cases were being considered for the registry. It is to date the largest and sort of the only comprehensive archive of cases across the United States that have resulted in exonerations. While the individual registry is quite well known and has been the focus of many discussions in criminal justice and academic research, in 2020, the National Registry launched the Groups Registry. The Groups Registry focuses on groups of defendants that are tied together by common patterns, primarily of systematic official misconduct in the investigation and prosecution of those cases that had undermined confidence in the underlying convictions. That data and the information in the Groups Registry is fascinating. It is handled in a way that's different from the individual cases, and so that's what we're going to be talking about on the panel today is what's unique about those group exoneration cases. We're going to be learning about how that Groups Registry was founded and incorporated into the National Registry, what the process is of evaluating those cases, and then there are going to be panelists, as I'll introduce in a moment, that are going to talk about how those cases emerge in the real world and what is being done and the actions that are being taken to identify those cases as they come up. So that's enough of me. I want to get to our panel. As I said, we've got three panelists here with us this morning and another Sam Gross, who is participating via Zoom. So I'm just going to go down the list here. Tara Thompson, sitting on the far left, is here with us this morning. She is a senior staff attorney with the Innocence Project. She spent the last 15 years exonerating the wrongfully convicted in both state and federal courts. Prior to her position at the Innocence Project, she was a partner pursuing civil rights remedies for her clients at the law firm Levi & Levi. And after that, spent 13 years at the Exoneration Project in Chicago, where she also taught at her alma mater, the University of Chicago Law School. She has successfully represented clients in cases involving DNA and fingerprint analysis, eyewitness misidentifications, false and coerced confessions, official misconduct, arson science, and forensic pathology. She's led post-conviction efforts at all stages of litigation, including motion practice, evidentiary hearings, appeals, and trials. Next to her is Ken Otterberg. Ken Otterberg is a researcher with the National Registry of Exonerations, where he's been since 2018. At the registry, he works with Maurice Pusley to research and write case summaries of all the exonerations that are added to the registry, and he is the primary researcher for the cases featured in the Groups Registry. Prior to joining the National Registry of Exonerations, he worked for the Winston-Salem Journal from 1990 to 2010, the last five of which he spent as the managing editor. The newspaper's investigation of a wrongful conviction was a principal factor in the creation of the North Carolina Innocence Inquiry Commission in 2006. As a freelance writer since 2010, his work has appeared in the Washington Post magazine, the New York Times, Fortune, National Geographic, and Longreads. To Ken's left is Deborah Levy. Deb is the Director of Special Litigation and a felony trial attorney for the Maryland Office of the Public Defender in Baltimore. Since she began with OPD in 2013, she's focused on police misconduct and has successfully led the OPD efforts to gain access to hundreds, if not thousands, of IED files that were never previously disclosed. She was also instrumental in uncovering and litigating the myriad issues arising in the now notorious Baltimore Police Department Gun Trace Task Force scandal, which has been described as the most extensive and damaging corruption scandal in the history of the Baltimore Police Department. Prior to her work with the OPD, she was a public defender in Salt Lake City. And finally, and who's going to start things off for us today, is Sam Gross. Professor Samuel Gross is the senior editor, and he is the co-founder of the National Registry of Exonerations. He's also the Thomas and Mabel Long Professor of Law Emeritus at the University of Michigan Law School, where he taught evidence, criminal procedure, and courses on false convictions and exonerations. He has litigated test cases on jury selection and capital trials, racial discrimination in the use of the death penalty, and the constitutionality of executing defendants in the face of a substantial known risk of innocence. Professor Gross has published many works on false convictions and exonerations, eyewitness identification, evidence law, pretrial settlement, and the selection of cases for trial and racial profiling. So we're gonna start with Professor Gross, and if you could help me figure out how to do that, we're going to be putting him up on the screen. Professor Gross and Ken Otterberg are gonna talk to us about the founding of the group's registry and what that process is and some of the decision making involved in making those cases available in the database. And then we're going to hear from Deb Levy talking about how those cases emerge in the context of the criminal cases on the front end. And then we'll hear from Tara Thompson about the civil litigation component of those cases, discovering them and how they're handled at that stage. Oh, yes.
Okay, Mr. Gross, can you unmute yourself?
I think I have.
You are on screen.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Ross. It's a pleasure to be here, although I wish I had the pleasure of being there in person, too. Let me see if I can get some slides. That's the plan. And if it works well, oops. Okay. Hold on. Let me try this one more time. Sorry.
Looks good here, Sam.
As Ross said, 3 years ago, I learned something. Okay, so this, this, as you can see, is the homepage of the website of the registry, and it has in the top right hand corner what we do that we're best known for, which is list exonerations, those that we know about since 1989. Over here, you see actually two places where we discuss exonerations since 1989. The first is this one, which is basically all of the cases that we know about where people have been exonerated in individual cases. It's 3,315 or 10 right now. This slide was put together a few days ago with lots of information on them. But there's also this one, which is the groups registry, which now has 30 separate groups totaling, as you'll see up there, over 35,000 exonerations. And these are quite different sets of cases. What I want to do is try to give you an idea of how we got to this situation, how we got to first identifying two very different sets of exonerations, and second, listing them as we do now in two separate lists. The story starts in 2004, long before the registry came into existence, when I was working on a study that was ultimately published in 2005, listing more exonerations across all types of crimes in the United States than anybody had put together. It ended up as 340. And I had a conversation with Peter Neufeld, who is, as I'm sure you know, one of the co-founders of the Innocence Project, and asked him to make a guess at what town had the most exonerations in this list of 340. And he came up with a very plausible guess, which was Chicago. I said, no, actually it's Tulia, Texas. And the reason for that was that Tulia, a few years earlier, had had something like, I can't remember the exact number, but I think it was like
35
exonerations in 1 year. Because a single undercover narcotics agent had spent several months supposedly investigating narcotics trafficking in Tulia and had booked in evidence amounts of cocaine, heavily diluted cocaine, which he claimed he bought from 35 or more separate people, separate coke dealers in Tulia, all of whom were arrested at once, almost all of whom were black. Most of whom were convicted over a fairly short period of time and got sentences ranging from probation to years in prison. And then the whole set of cases fell apart. It turned out that this was all fiction, that he had made up all of these stories and falsified his reports, that the drugs came from his own private stash. He was eventually convicted of perjury, and they were all exonerated. And that was a big event. And Peter, of course, knew about it, and his reaction is, oh, no, that's different. They don't count as exonerations. If you're going to count those, you have to count the Rampart cases in Los Angeles as well. And I said, what are those, the Rampart cases in Los Angeles? And he told me, and I started checking, and that was another set of cases in which police officers, in that case a group in a particular police area in Los Angeles, among other misdeeds, went on a program of falsifying, fabricating cases of crimes against people they wanted to arrest, mostly undocumented immigrants from Central America, mostly drug cases, some gun possession cases, and that eventually all came apart. But on that one, we had very poor information. After years of investigation, estimates of the number of exonerees, nothing like a clear idea of who was exonerated or what happened to them or where they were then, or for that matter, what their names were. But everyone knew that the general pattern had occurred and that as a result, there was no doubt that quite a few people were convicted and later exonerated of crimes they didn't commit. We decided at that point, me and other researchers on that study, that these cases were fundamentally different. And noted them in the report as mass exonerations, which we weren't going to include. By the time it was published, we knew the third one was a little smaller. And basically described them as something different, what I just described and what was mentioned before, cases in which the defendants were the objects of systematic programs of police corruption that resulted in false convictions for fabricated crimes, drug crimes. By the time the registry went public in 2012, by then we had something like 870 some exonerations that we listed in the report that we issued at that time. We also knew of 11 different exonerations, totaling about 1,100 defendants between them, and had a section of the report devoted to them, but also said, we're not going to include them. And that's because they're a fundamentally different thing, and that's not what we're studying. And there are other problems with them, which I'll get to in a few minutes. And that's how we continue to operate for several years until 2018, when two important things happened. The first is that we hired Ken Outterbourg, who you'll hear from next. Whose job description included spending half of his time putting together information, systematic information on group exonerations, because this we knew by then that this was a big, important area in which false convictions were occurring on a regular basis across the United States and resulting in large numbers of exonerations, but they were understudied, not well reported, and we were not doing much useful to cover them except note that they existed. And the second is we reconsidered our position that we wouldn't include them in the registry as we then had it. And that's where I'm going to get to this slide, which basically is what I'm going to spend the last few minutes that I have here, which is a short description of the differences between individual exonerations and group exonerations. First, this was an overwhelming pattern we started. Individual exonerations are mostly violent crimes. When we started, 90-some of the ones we knew about, 90-some percent were murder cases and rape cases. That's down a good deal, and we know quite a few other exonerations of other sorts now. But still, even now, for individual exonerations, more than 3/4% are violent crimes. For group exonerations, almost all are for drug crimes. Second, and this follows from the fact that drug crimes, unlike the individual exonerations, the violent crimes, which are reported by the public, or not reported, except in homicide cases, most are not reported, and those that are reported are investigated by the police. Obviously, and we all know that drug crimes are not reported, and countless numbers, at one point I estimated over 1 million a day of drug crimes are committed across the United States. A tiny fraction of them result in investigations and arrests, and those that do are not there because they're reported, but because the police chose to investigate, search, and arrest those people. Third, most of the exonerees are people of color, about 2/3 individual exonerees, and about half are black. That's evidence of strong patterns of racial discrimination across crimes, which we've talked about in a couple of important reports. But for group exonerees, the pattern is much stronger than that. 97% of them are people of color, and 80% are black, which pretty much follows from the fact that these are drug cases where the police officers get to choose who to pursue, because in general, the war on drugs is heavily a war against drug suspects or people of color, especially black Americans. Almost all, not almost all, but the vast majority of individual exonerations are after convictions at trial. That tells you something both about the nature of the crimes, murders have lower guilty plea rate than other crimes, for example, but also because that these people are often people who resist pleading guilty because they don't want to accept a guilty plea to a crime they didn't commit. That is much less true of people who are falsely charged with drug crimes. Of the group exonerees that we know about, almost all were convicted by guilty pleas, like most, like the great majority of all convicted defendants in the United States. And they received comparatively low sentences. Some of them got sentences of 5, 6, 10 years in prison. But by comparison, the individual exonerees include a lot of people, you know, over 110 or so, were sentenced to death. Hundreds were sentenced to life imprisonment. The mean sentences for those who weren't are in the decades. Very different population in terms of sentences. And as a result, among the individual exonerees, almost all are in prison, a great majority when they're exonerated, whereas the group exonerees are overwhelmingly people who were released often years before. Some of them are not exonerated even though they could be because they can't be located. And then we get to the last thing, last few issues. And one is the procedural one. There is, with few exceptions, strong resistance to almost all individual exonerations. In the group cases, that's quite variable. But in many of them, there's strong resistance until the dam breaks. So in Thule, the dam breaks when this dishonest police officer is uncovered, and then all of the cases flow downstream at once. Everybody gets exonerated within a period of a few weeks. Something like that occurred in many cases. In Philadelphia, for example, which for a long time had the largest numbers of group exonerations we knew about, the district attorney took a position that if a defendant was in a group, had been arrested by an officer who's tainted by this misconduct. A known bad actor was a part of this conspiracy to commit this type of misconduct, then she would dismiss the case against him, period. That makes a lot of sense. Nobody would do that for a murder conviction, especially since the defendant would like to be in prison and people would complain about releasing guilty people from prison, etc. The victims would be up in arms, or might be, or the police union might get them to be upset. Drug crimes are victimless, and the defendants who were exonerated were mostly already out of jail, and even if they're released, that's just adding, you know, a tiny number of defendants to the huge mountain of cases of guilty drug offenders who were never investigated, let alone convicted. So there are many cases in which, once the pattern is established, people get exonerated, have charges dismissed against them, just by being on a list of people by certain criteria. And that gets me to the last two parts here, which are the differences that were most important for the registry function. One is, for many of the cases in the group exonerations, we have extremely limited information about the case, including in many of them, in many thousands at this point, not knowing the names of the people, or the dates in which the crime occurred, or the date in which the exoneration occurred, and so forth. The individual exonerations, we almost always have detailed information, and we require sufficient detailed information to identify, to describe all the things I've just mentioned in order to include them in law. The second is, for the individual exonerations, we are confident of their factual innocence because the criteria that we use are such that it is very unlikely that people who are guilty would get through that sieve. And we can talk about this later if you're curious, but that's been our belief since the beginning, and it has basically been borne out. With the group exonerations, that is not the case. If the basis for group exoneration is something like what it has been and still is in Philadelphia in many cases, this person was arrested by a dirty officer, we have low confidence in the factual innocence in the particular case, which is later dismissed, because dirty officers arrest guilty people as well as innocent people. And we have no way of knowing which is which, if we even know enough information about the name of the defendant and the dates, etc., to include them. So the second thing we did in 2018 was figure out how to reconcile these two conflicting sets of cases, given that some cases in the group exoneration category look a lot like individual cases. That means two things. First, that we have sufficiently detailed information to say who was exonerated, what crime they were convicted of, when it happened, what their sentence was, the process that led to that, etc. We have enough information to describe the case individually. And second, that we're confident of their innocence, which was true in quite a few cases. For example, in the Tulia cases, we knew enough at the outset to say we're pretty confident in the innocence of every one or almost every one of these people to the extent that we care, but the process that led to the exonerations is the sort of process that we believe produces a list of overwhelmingly innocent defendants. Here's how we adjusted our process to get to where we are now. This is the definition of exoneration that we had before late 1918. And basically, the person is exonerated if they were convicted of a crime, then relieved of all the consequences of the conviction, either by being declared factually innocent, typically get a certificate of innocence or pardon based on innocence, or got a pardon, acquittal, or dismissal, not based on innocence, after new evidence of innocence emerged. That would apply to all of the group exonerations because, assuming there was enough information to identify the people, etc., because new evidence of innocence did develop in all these cases, and the charges were dismissed, and the new evidence of innocence was that these officers were dishonest, and therefore more likely to be lying, and therefore the evidence of the guilt that was used against them was not as good as it appeared to be. But that didn't alleviate our uncertainty about their innocence under the facts of the process. And that led us to add a factor which you see here in red, that this process that led to the defendant being relieved of the consequence of convictions followed a post-conviction re-examination of the evidence in the case. That, of course, is true in all of the individual exonerations. It almost has to be. But in the group cases, where you can get charges dismissed just by being on a list of people who were arrested by Officer Coleman, there is no re-examination of the evidence and no attempt whatever to determine if the person is innocent beyond the fact they're in this group of people who are the subject of conduct by a dirty officer. So that is now an additional requirement that applies to all our cases, and that has allowed us to decide that some of the cases that are in the list of in this list of 30 some groups with thousands of exonerees also qualify for the individual registry. You see that over here in this column, number of defendants in the individual registry, and it varies. In many cases, it's zero. In some cases, in California in 1999, that is the loss of the Rampart case, that 48 of 171 exonerees are also listed in the individual registry, but the great majority are not. In the Tulia case, which was on this slide, it would be 100% of them, or 99%. Ken will tell you more about that. And that is where I end and turn this over to Ken.
Good morning. Thank you, Sam. I thought what I'd try to do during my time is to give everybody a tour of the group's registry and tell you what information is in there, how it got there, and what we are learning as we build this new registry. Currently, as Sam mentioned, we have 37 groups in our registry representing the wrongful convictions of nearly 36,000 individuals. And just take a moment to think about that 36,000 individuals. Now, two of those groups, the Massachusetts drug lab cases, account for about 32,000 of those wrongful convictions. But if you take those out, then the average group has about 114 members. So as Sam said, this is our homepage. So there are cases that are widely known and are part of the lexicon of wrongful convictions. Tulia, Rampart, Watts, to name a few. And then there are others that receive little or no attention beyond the local level. This includes defendants in rural Georgia, Richmond, Virginia, Iberia Parish, Louisiana, and others. Our oldest case begins in 1944 with the wrongful conviction of 28 servicemen in Fort Lawton, Washington. The red pins, so here's a map. The red pins represent jurisdictions where there are multiple groups. Blue pins are ones where there are individual groups. The yellow pins represent jurisdictions where we have confirmed groups, but we haven't entered the information for the cases yet. More on that later. As Sam mentioned, we use a different lens when researching a group's exoneration. The pivot point, so to speak, is most often the official misconduct that connects the members of the group. Generally speaking, in my experience, there are three basic patterns. The first would be what I would call active misconduct. For example, in the Tulia cases or the Watts cases from Chicago, the corrupt officer was planting drugs on defendants. The second would be what I would call passive misconduct, built largely around impeachment evidence. I've heard people refer to these as but-for cases, i.e. but-for the testimony or reports of the now discredited official actor, is there a viable case for sustaining the conviction? The third category are the hybrids, and these are the most common. There's active misconduct, but it's sometimes difficult to ascertain a precise number of cases where it occurred. So some of the convictions are vacated and then dismissed based on the active harm, but the majority are dismissed based on impeachment evidence. For example, this is present in our group's case out of Jackson County, Florida, which is just near Tallahassee. There's clear evidence that the sheriff's deputy, Zach Wester, planted drugs on one person, this woman, Teresa Odom. There's the video of it. It's less clear for the other 87 defendants, but their convictions are still tainted. The result is that some defendants, such as Ms. Odom, are in the main registry, but the others are not. The reasons are varied. Either there is unexplained physical evidence of guilt, or there wasn't what Sam we call an individualized level of review, which Sam discussed earlier. So how do we find groups? When I was hired at the registry and we began building the groups registry, we had a backlog of cases to enter, such as the Rampart case and the Tulia case. And I spent much of my time trying to find what I considered to be the true universe of defendants for each of these cases and as much information about each group as possible. Sometimes the group was larger than I thought, sometimes it was smaller. The research can be difficult. Often these cases leave few footprints for several reasons. First, they are most often drug cases. Second, they most commonly end in pleas. In addition, many of the research on many of these older cases is hampered because the documents are not online and we have a limited travel budget. So in the Rampart case, which involved these corrupt officers in the Los Angeles Police Department, we were fortunate enough that a law professor named Russell Covey, who some of you might know, had written a law review article about the case. I contacted him and learned he had collected the writ petitions for approximately 65 defendants. Remarkably, he was finished with the research and he said I could have it, and then he shipped me all the documents. And there they are in my closet. Don't worry, they've been digitized. But they're a remarkable collection of a wrongful conviction. For many of these groups, we end up triangulating. Often a list of defendants is hard to come by, and we will find possible members from civil rights lawsuits filed after cases are dismissed. These documents give us dates and details about misconduct, about crimes, about sentences, and other aspects of the case. They may lead us to new defendants. In the Rampart case, we also had access to transcripts of the interviews that Officer Rafael Perez gave to investigators trying to unravel the extent of his misconduct. This gives us texture, context, and new leads as we make our way forward. We cross-check information, contacting attorneys and others when things aren't clear. As with all our registry work, we only write and code what we know. And we are conservative about how we interpret facts. For example, as Sam mentioned, we view claims of factual innocence differently if they are only asserted in post-exoneration litigation. Just as individual exonerations are still taking place, we published 233 individual exonerations that occurred in 2022. Group exonerations are also not a thing of the past. Since we launched the group site, we have posted 13 contemporary cases. These are recent examples of mass injustice. So how do we find these cases? Some are hard to miss. For example, many of you may be aware of the police officer in Houston named Gerald Goines. He was involved in a tragic shooting death that occurred during a no-knock raid. It turns out that Officer Goines had also falsified information on a search warrant related to this raid. The Harris County DA, Kimberly Ogg, began investigating. Her office's conviction integrity unit reviewed drug cases where Goines was the essential but-for witness. And then prosecutors joined the public defender's office in asking the Texas Court of Criminal Appeals to begin granting defendants writ petitions. Slowly, the appellate court is granting these petitions. There will be perhaps 60 or 70 members of this group when all is said and done. Right now, we know of six. Separately, there is a small group in Wake County, North Carolina. We learned of this in a roundabout way. My fellow researcher, Maurice Posley, and I, we have a series of Google News alerts that we check every day. For example, new trial, prosecutorial misconduct, exoneration, etc. From these searches, we read about a defendant in Raleigh getting his case thrown out last year because of misconduct committed by a police officer and questions about the reliability of the officer's confidential informant. I called up the attorney. It turned out there were two defendants who had been exonerated. We wrote and posted those cases, and I made a note to circle back to the attorney. 2 weeks ago, I circled back again. He told me about four other post-conviction dismissals. Those cases, unlike the previous two, won't be individual exonerations because their cases didn't meet the heavy review level that we wanted. There's a more cursory review of the facts. When I examined their motions for appropriate relief, there were the same typos in all the motions. So there's a uniformity to them that shows they're being handled in a different manner. In essence, the district attorney is conceding that these new defendants meet the parameters for dismissal and they get to ride the ride. Just a few days ago, I learned of a third new group out of Westchester County, New York. It's exciting and interesting to enter these new cases, but I'm also aware that each of these groups is a collective story of wrongful conviction and the lives disrupted in the process. We often say that the registry publishes all known exonerations in the United States. We work hard at finding cases, but it's clear that there are cases we don't know about. It's the same for group exonerations. Dismissing six convictions for drug crimes is different than dismissing charges for a person serving life for murder. These are most often nonviolent crimes, and they can be done with little notice and fanfare. So registry entry has two components. First is the summary or narrative of the case. And this is part of the narrative for the Rampart case. What happened? The second is the coding that powers the database. For the group's registry, we code all sorts of information, from the type of misconduct to the dates of the dismissals and the amount of compensation that exonerees received. This is part of our coding scheme. We update both parts as new information becomes available. Many of these newer cases are still with us and will be for quite some time. This is why we refer to the registry in all its forms as a living archive. Because we only have 37 cases so far, it's still pretty early to mine the data and find patterns, especially when you have 32,000 wrongful convictions that can overwhelm the rest of the database. At this point, our goal is to build and to add. Although it's not directly reflecting the data, our research leads me to believe that this is an area where prosecutors play a critical role. It's not that prosecutors aren't important in individual exonerations, they are. But groups' cases quite often hinge on prosecutors being proactive rather than reactive. Because these are low-level, nonviolent crimes in most cases, defendants typically receive lighter prison sentences. Often by the time the misconduct is discovered, most defendants are out of prison and they've moved on with their life, even if they're still bearing the collateral consequences of this wrongful conviction. These defendants may not connect the dots between an officer's arrest on a perjury charge and their own conviction. In some places, such as Philadelphia, New York, and I've heard it on some good authority, Baltimore as well, we've seen public defenders and other organizations actively push for reexamination of cases, often with remarkable results, after misconduct by police has been brought to life. For example, in New York, more than 450 convictions were vacated based on misconduct by Officer Joseph Franco or failure to disclose this misconduct. But it's a different story in jurisdictions where there isn't a robust public defenders organization. All too often, the local defense bar may have little incentive or ability to proceed. By and large, innocence organizations, which do such incredible work, don't litigate post-conviction claims involving drug crimes. What that means is that after there is compelling evidence that an officer has committed misconduct, the burden can fall on prosecutors to review convictions, identify cases, and notify defendants that they need to contact an attorney. This is what is happening in Houston. It happened in Brooklyn. It even happened in Hennepin County, Minnesota. But if you recall the map I showed you earlier, there's a lot of our country where there are no markers. My guess is that in many of those states, there are either actual group exonerations that we don't know about or possible group exonerations that got lost in the shuffle with the pressing needs of running a prosecutorial office or got pushed to the side after prosecutors were never properly challenged after they deemed the impeachment evidence was immaterial to the integrity of the conviction. We all know that reviewing these claims is what justice demands. It's neither liberal or conservative, it's the right thing to do. So in closing, I want to add one thing, which is sort of a personal plea. When these convictions are thrown out and the charges dismissed, tell the registry. This is how we build trust in the criminal justice system. First, we rectify errors, and then we acknowledge them in a public space so we can learn to do better. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. And as promised, next we're going to hear about, we just heard a little bit about Baltimore, apparently. I think he got one of the red pins. So we're going to ask Deb Levy to tell us a little bit about her experiences at the OPD and kind of seeing these cases emerge in the real world of a local criminal justice system. We're good here. Where is my... I don't know what that is. Yes.
Okay. All right.
You should be good. Okay.
Good morning.
Oh. All right.
I know. I'm stalling. Good morning. Good morning to my colleague, Ms. Nethercott. It's nice to see you. One of our heroes in Baltimore. I always tell people it's more nerve-wracking to talk in front of other lawyers than it is in front of a jury, so don't judge. So, all right, my name's Debbie. I'm with the Office of the Public Defender in Baltimore. Some people say that I came to Baltimore in 2013 and started specializing in police misconduct, but I just came to Baltimore in 2013, and police misconduct found me because it was in nearly every one of my cases that we suspected in a certain jurisdiction in Baltimore. And from there, we sort of wrote the story of what's happening and why don't we have these files, and the story's unfolded. Some of you may have heard about the Gun Trace Task Force. I guess by show of hands, has anybody heard about the Gun Trace Task Force in Baltimore? And this is an excellent story that was Jessica Lusenhop did in the BBC. And I just want to play for you this morning, maybe to wake you up. It's a little bit, indulge me, 2 minutes, but I'm going to give you a clip because this is a real life clip of what happens in Baltimore with Gun Trace Task Force officers who terrorize citizens in Baltimore. And then we'll talk about what do we do to find folks who were terrorized and victims and how do we fix that.
Sir, I'm Sergeant Wayne Jangles with the Gun Trace Task Force. So we need you to help me stop there and sit on the seat bottle. Have a minute on the seat bottle, sir.
Detective Sergeant Wayne Jenkins.
Sir, how long have you been employed with the police department?
Wayne Jenkins, being a police officer, going after the bad guys.
What's in the bag?
He's very smart, he knew the law.
He was seen as, like, super cop. That guy gets the job done.
He was on TV at a frequent basis. Unbelievable bust in Baltimore City.
Jenkins commandeers a city van, takes it into the middle of the riot, grabs these cops, and he rescues them. Wayne Jenkins is awarded a Bronze Star for his actions. What people didn't know, the supposed hero went out later and robbed the people looting the drugstores.
I got promoted to sergeant, I believe, in 2010, and then I was placed in Gun Trace Task Force for Baltimore City.
In Baltimore, the officers would stop you. They may take your money, but they wouldn't arrest you. Wayne Jenkins upped the ante. He was going to rob you, break in your house, and he was going to arrest you.
Why can't I look and see what's going on in my car?
It's shocking how brazen he was.
He put the unit in sort of hyperspeed.
He's a psychopath. He's gangster. That badge and that gun, man, cut him loose.
I couldn't see anybody. I only saw you guys walk around my walkway.
We quickly realized that they were just robbing people left and right on the streets.
I'll make a mistake.
He had turned into something that was not even close to being a police officer.
We weren't sitting there minding our business. And then...
Who they want to believe? A so-called officer or a person that had a criminal history? I'm a dead man walking.
The criminal justice system is built to believe the words of officers. Because if you don't, then that erodes our belief in what's right and what's wrong.
They lie. That's what they do, right?
These guys had the power to say whatever they wanted to say, and people were going to believe it. Baltimore City Police Department, they didn't care. They just wiped their hands of everything.
I
that's actually streaming now on Amazon and I think Apple TV, if you wanted to see that whole movie, I Got a Monster. One of the reasons, sorry, let's see, this always happens when I'm... Yeah, let me just try to get to the next slide, my bad. Okay, there we go. So you saw a courtroom in that video, and that's a courtroom that I was sitting in when we heard the news, February 23rd, 2017, that eight of the Gun Trace Task Force officers were indicted. As a public defender in Baltimore, we were representing people who were alleging misconduct by these officers, for me at least, for 4 years, and for many other people, many, many, many more years. And so as we get now to the group exoneration registry, a whole lot of work had to happen before then. So you can imagine our sort of fear, frustration, anxiety. Immediately when this happens, what are we going to do to go back and look at everybody who's in prison? Overnight, how do we develop a system to try to find people and get them out of prison? So the first thing that we had to do, literally like overnight, was identify cases. The police department, the prosecutor's office, came out into the media and said, we're going to identify cases. We think we see 300 cases. Well, we really did not agree with that because we just thought that that was an entirely untrustworthy number. We did a very cursory review and immediately found over 2,000 people who we thought needed to be exonerated immediately. How did we do that? And how does this work in real life if any of you are ever sitting in this most unfortunate situation? We had our public state database called Case Search. In not every jurisdiction is it free, and in not every jurisdiction are you able to search it, to the capacity that we did. But here's exactly how it went down for us. We put in by hand each officer's name, and we searched how many cases did they have open. I started with Wayne Jenkins. We run a list of Wayne Jenkins cases, and in the bottom of our public case search database, we can actually export to Excel. And then I have to have somebody in my office go, by the way, we created this unit like sort of immediately as this was happening, and we had to identify by hand, because I've now sorted by officer, put in each case number by hand to find a defendant. People are shaking their heads. Not easy work. There's no system in place, and this fear and anxiety of like, who am I going to leave behind as I'm doing this? So we had multiple spreadsheets working in our office. We were manually identifying folks. We had to hire folks, train them, get people invested in this work because it is tedious, taking a very long time to do. And then we have to search VineLink for who's in custody. Then we established a hotline in our office. Then we had to gather charge papers, literally by the thousands of, if we couldn't find the files, we had to run to the courthouse, give the records division a long list because we're not electronic yet. And then we had to convince the state's attorney's office that this officer was material in the case worthy of exonerating our client. Then we had to find our clients. Because you can't file a motion to dismiss a case if you don't have permission. And then we have to find out who's represented by private counsel, because private counsel doesn't want us doing this work for them if this is going to be their moment of glory and the public defenders can't go do it, and they want that opportunity. It's true, they were really going to be angry with us and were angry if we were sort of taking their clients. It was really sort of a difficult mess. Then we had to, after we called the list and we developed thousands of people on our list, literally then looking at each defendant in case search, just who is in prison because this low-level drug offense violated their probation in another case. And so we had to connect the dots and do the maze, and that still is going on today. People who were in prison who had a low-level drug conviction, who then got all of their backup time on a robbery, and I have to follow that trail and convince somebody to do something to let them out of prison. We identified serious felonies and misdemeanors, and this is, if anybody hasn't used it, VineLink, which is really what sort of helped save the day for us. I will say, I will part a little bit with my esteemed colleagues from the National Registry of Exonerations, because they were not all low-level drug offenses in Maryland. The first priority, and I will give the state's attorney's office credit, the first priority for all of us was who's incarcerated. And then from there, we sort of delineated who's incarcerated on a homicide that they're not going to touch and who's incarcerated on something lower level. Where the Quattrone Center may come in if this happens ever in the future is that we had to partner with our local academic institutions. I am a public defender. I do not know anything about really data collection. Well, now I do. But at the time, I didn't really know what a scraper was, except when I was a waitress and you got a scraper on the table to clean the crumbs. That was my scraper. But UB, University of Baltimore, helped us develop a scraper. We also worked with a group called Open Justice Baltimore. Unfortunately, our case search, our statewide case database system, has now built something to prohibit scrapers. So we're sort of back to the drawing board. Hopefully we've gotten most of the cases that we can find. So what did we do once we found these folks? Well, we did have a dedicated partner at the state's attorney's office for Baltimore City, a wonderful man named Tony Joya, who helped us immediately to file joint motions to withdraw guilty pleas, motions for new trial, and joint motions to vacate convictions. We totally made this motion up out of thin air. It did not exist. And unfortunately, there wasn't really a rule for it. This is what it looked like. It was very, very simple. We said this person was arrested, this person went to court, and by the way, these officers have just been indicted for horrible conduct, and we all agree this conviction should go away. And it was great. We got into court, we quickly moved them, and then we didn't, because lots and lots of judges in Baltimore City Circuit Court didn't think that this fell within our rule, which is 4-331, motions for new trial in Maryland. It has to be filed timely, within 10 days after verdict, or 90 days after judgment in district, 90 days after judgment in circuit. Thereafter, the court has the revisory power and control over the judgment in a case of fraud, mistake, or irregularity. So we thought, well, fraud definitely smells like fraud to us. It's definitely irregular, and it might have been a mistake that they didn't go get their records and turn them over. And so we felt confident in filing those pleadings, and we had a small group of judges who really just dug their heels in and said, we don't really care, we don't think it qualifies under any of those. And so you can imagine a world where you've got somebody in prison, you're walking in on a joint motion, and a judge is denying. I remember my colleague Matt Siegel in Massachusetts, who was doing all of the drug cases, and I'm like, Matt, how are you doing this? And he had in his motion for new trial, the motion for new trial statute or rule in Massachusetts says at any time you can go back and undo a conviction. And so the state's attorney's office and the public defenders, we were both drafting our own new legislation in Maryland to go back and be able to undo a conviction at any time. The state's attorney's office won. This is our 8-301.1 state's motion to vacate probation before judgment or a conviction. The motion has to be filed in writing, has to have detailed grounds, and our difficulty with the statute is only the state can file. And so in the very, very beginning, we were dependent on a veteran state's attorney who had excellent discretion, who would help us file these motions together, really with fairness as the beacon. When that individual leaves, then you're left with somebody who may hold a different position. And so now you are really at the whim of a single state's attorney, one who on one day may choose to speak with us, one day may not. It was a mystery. And they came sort of to a screeching halt as we started to finish all of the low-level drug cases. The state has the burden of proof. The defendant has to be notified. And I'm going to talk just a little bit about the rule. The biggest thing is that the motion may be filed at any time after a judgment has been entered. So that was wonderful for us. The motion has to be very specific. I have actually been standing in court when a judge would deny our joint motion to vacate because the judge did not think, in her estimation, that the police officer was material to the conviction, or the state's attorney's office didn't do enough to say why. It's a little bit frustrating because sometimes it's hard to gather that information. and this is just sort of... I'm not going to go through sort of all of the contents of the motion to vacate, but you can see I'm still going through the requirements in a motion to vacate. It's very specific in Maryland what the prosecutor has to show and what burden they have to overcome. So we do not just walk into court and get these motions granted for no reason. It was used in a very high-profile case that some of you may recently have heard about, just in full disclosure. It's what they used in the Adnan Syed case, and that is winding its way through the appellate court on whether they gave in Maryland the victims enough opportunity to be heard. And so that is sort of how we really broke the dam, to use Sam's phrase, and got a bunch of convictions through the system. But on a practical level, sort of where are we, and are we still landing cases in the exoneration registry, and what are some challenges? So I just want to talk about that. I don't even know how much time I have. I didn't know when I started.
You're okay, yeah.
Okay, so by show of hands, do we have any prosecutors in the room today? Okay, wonderful. So. One of the problems for us as public defenders is prosecutors really being able to hold all the cards for us in this scenario. And so there was a list of officers who were eligible after the Gun Trace Task Force indictments came out. And through the trial, we learned about other officers who were what we call GTTF adjacent. And we had a list of these officers, and we had to really go back and forth negotiating with the state's attorney's office. When does this start? What is the arbitrary start date that we're gonna get for their misconduct? So if it happened in 2009, based on the testimony at trial with Daniel Herschel, what about the person who's sitting in prison December 2008? Do we want to agree that Daniel Herschel woke up overnight in 2009 and became one of the worst, most notorious officers in the history of Baltimore? And he wasn't doing anything wrong in 2008, but that is the hard line that our state's attorney's office drew, which leaves us in a very difficult spot. We also have officers on our list who, for whatever reason, are still being used. True story, I was really going to talk about an individual this morning named Kenneth Ivory, who was a sergeant in the Baltimore Police Department, who is a sergeant in the Baltimore Police Department. And I lied to you not that I'm sitting in court one day with the state's attorney as we are reading a motion to vacate into the record, asking the judge to vacate. And I am literally at that very same time defending a drug case in which Sergeant Ivory had participated, also, by the way, with an illegal search. This morning, Ken walked in and said, "Hey, Debbie, did you hear there's a $450,000 settlement being approved with the Board of Estimates in Baltimore, also for Kenneth Ivory, for what he alleges to be illegal planting?" So it's really sort of a mystery to us. How are you vacating these convictions and using these officers still in prosecution? And it keeps us all up at night, and unfortunately is keeping people wrongfully in prison. Officers are also moving from one jurisdiction to another. In response to this, we have created one of what I think is the best statewide police misconduct databases in the country, and we try to help track officers, catalog their misconduct, and make sure, at least if they're traveling through the state of Maryland, we will catch them. And then what about this issue of the more serious crimes that prosecutors are overlooking? And so I just want to, while I have this moment as a public defender, candidly, I'm usually at a criminal defense conference, but I love the opportunity to speak to prosecutors on this issue, because maybe you also don't get to hear our perspective or our side on what is this cautionary tale for you. So, for example, I am recently litigating a case that the state's attorney's office refuses to touch on an officer with serious misconduct where they decided not to disclose for whatever reason. Maybe they didn't know. Maybe they didn't have the information constructively or actually. And, I updated it and the wrong one was pulled up. So I'll tell you what happened. A good trial lawyer always comes prepared with a backup. Aha. So order, this is from May 5th. Three, the court has considered Mr. So-and-so's motion for new trial, the state's opposition thereto, and the oral arguments of counsel. And for the reasons stated herein, my memorandum pursuant to Maryland Rule 4331, by this fifth day of May 2023, by the Circuit Court of Baltimore City, ordered that the defendant's request for new trial is hereby granted. This is a motion for new trial in a double homicide because the state doesn't want to go back and look at the bad information that wasn't previously disclosed. My client has been sitting in prison since 2018 on a double homicide for, by the way, which he also alleges innocence, but the focus is really on the fact that there was a corrupt officer involved in this case. And the state didn't want to bring that information forward. So now what we have is an individual who has been technically, I guess, exonerated. And I have a written opinion in the Baltimore City Circuit Court that says this is clearly a Brady violation in this case by the state. So now my cautionary tale for the prosecutors is when you say I don't want to disturb a murder conviction because it's against public policy, because it will hurt the victim's families, because we don't want to go backwards, because we don't want to roll over on that. Now you've disturbed a murder conviction, you've had to go back to the families and explain why you didn't disclose this information in the first place, and now you have a prosecutor who's in jeopardy because I have a written Brady violation opinion that their office is going to have to pay attention to. And in fact, I'm discussing last night at dinner, what are we still going to do about that? And so when we look back at these convictions and seek to exonerate, my sort of word to the wise, my request going forward from everybody who's thinking about these is that justice always be your beacon, and doing the right thing and getting a fair conviction, if you're going to get one at all, be the most important guiding factor, not the substance of the offense or the trouble and the heat that you may accept if you go back to look to undo it.
Okay, thank you very much. That was pretty interesting. I knew about the Baltimore Gun Trace Task Force, and you know, there's been some recent coverage that a lot of those issues are surfacing again through other units, and so very interesting to hear those perspectives about those cases. So next is Tara Thompson, who's with the Innocence Project, is going to talk to us about, you know, after this kind of frontline event that's happening in the criminal case, what happens on the civil side, and what are the other ways and the problems and issues that have to be addressed in order to get holistic justice for those people that have been subjected to these factors that go into the group exoneration. So, Tara?
Make sure that we have time for some questions and some conversation about this panel. So we'll definitely leave time for that. But before we go to that, I do want to offer just some additional perspective about especially the ways that civil litigation can help aid in investigation of these cases. You know, we started out with Sam talking about, you know, his conversation with Peter, where they agreed that these cases are different because there isn't this same understanding maybe or acceptance or even opportunity to reinvestigate folks' innocence in some of these groups' cases. And for me as an Innocence Project attorney, as someone in the Innocence Movement, that's really the issue, I think, for me, is thinking about, are there ways in these types of group cases to go back and establish innocence for folks, or is there a way to take these patterns and to learn something from that that will assist in other innocence cases and other innocence work. It's really the point I think that Deborah, other people have made in this panel, which is that the reason that folks have success getting their cases vacated in these types of groups cases is because at least ultimately there is an agreement that there's misconduct or that there's material misconduct that's relevant that results in folks' convictions getting vacated. For some of these folks, though, they're, you know, because there's not an opportunity to reinvestigate, like has been talked about by the panel, sometimes that reinvestigation is something that doesn't happen until civil litigation. And sometimes it's also civil litigation that ends up being the place where more folks that that have wrongful convictions, where those cases are identified. That comes from opportunities to do civil discovery, where through access to depositions, access to more robust document requests and document discovery, and frankly, just access to more factual investigation just leads to a greater understanding of what's occurred in some of these cases. And you can see that if you go through these groups cases that are in the groups registry, you can see that some of the factual development, I mean, even what Ken was talking about, you know, some of the learning about these cases really didn't come until there was lawyers involved who'd done more digging and collecting and investigating. I would just offer as an aside, you know, to jump on Deborah's plea bandwagon about this, that that doesn't have to wait till civil litigation to happen. I mean, that is something that folks in these official investigations could do if they wanted to. It's something that prosecutors could do if they wanted to. There may be practical limitations to doing that on the prosecution side or even in internal police investigations, but it's not something that has to wait for the civil lawyers to do. I think just practically sometimes that's where people have to wait to get that fuller reinvestigation of what has happened. I would also say, just in thinking about the lessons that, you know, civil litigation has to offer to this process, that this really does go to the question, I think, again, that Deborah alluded to at the end of her presentation, which is, you know, in the civil litigation side, and there's obviously the criminal corollary to this too, you know, you're thinking about this in the context of 404B, you know, the rule about people's prior misconduct that's part of a pattern or that's part of something that shows plan, intent, all of the things that are listed in 404B, thinking about why that prior misconduct is relevant, how it has evidentiary relevance. And I think that that sort of way that folks do that investigation for 404B purposes for civil litigation ends up or can end up informing how we think about these cases on the criminal side. You know, when someone has an MO that you've identified, you know, this is the way this person does their job, this is the way they do this thing, that's something that's admissible, you know, for civil purposes for 404B. It's not something that usually stops at a particular year or where we assume, yeah, you know, this is something you did in this one case, but we're going to assume it never happened another time. You know, I think you can assume that if someone has an MO of doing their job a certain way, or if you, again, if you look at the group's registry, you read the Rampart case description in there, for instance, where the officers in the Rampart scandal are saying, you know, I just started putting cases on people because I assumed they'd done something, so I was putting something on them. Why wouldn't you assume that that's someone's MO in lots of cases, and why wouldn't we treat that as having value in thinking about how we're going to reinvestigate potential wrongful convictions? The other point that I really want to highlight about this, which is something that ends up being a big part of any good civil reinvestigation and should be a part, I think, of any good innocence reinvestigation or groups exoneration reinvestigation, really is, you know, something that I would think about as like a Christopher Columbus problem, which is when there's sort of the worst way that innocence lawyers or even, you know, official reinvestigations approach this work is like coming to a misconduct problem that impacts a particular community and thinking that you discovered the problem. You know, Christopher Columbus didn't discover America. America, the people were here already. You know, like these problems of misconduct, of the impacts they have on communities, those problems are there already. And frankly, they're known by the impacted communities already. And for those of us doing this work, especially, you know, white people doing this work that are not part of these communities, like we think we discovered these problems, but we didn't. The people who are living with them know them. And the people who are in communities that are facing this misconduct understand it exists. So how do we as lawyers, whether it's our goal to serve those communities or whether we're just people trying to think about these systems, you know, not involving those communities in these investigations, it's just like the worst mistake that we can make. And so, you know, Deborah alluded to this too, having a hotline, having an opportunity for people to get involved, the data work that you did, you know, bringing in folks who are impacted by this to be involved in these cases is really, really important and frankly leads to better outcomes because, you know, the video that you saw, like people know when they're getting pulled over, they know there's this problem and people know these are the people in my community, you know, the police coming into my community that are causing these problems. They're aware of that. So getting those people involved and using their expertise as part of the investigation or making sure that those folks are being part of any reinvestigation is really, really, really important. And I think that's something that just doesn't happen enough. You know, good civil attorneys are going out and doing reinvestigation that knocks on doors, that figures out who's, you know, who are the witnesses in this case. We can be doing that in earlier parts of these investigations too, to try to identify cases and identify, you know, innocent folks and how those folks should be addressed. I think the last thing that I want to say about this as well is that, you know, when you look at the group's registry, and I think, you know, Ken and other folks have talked about that, have talked about, you know, prosecutors being proactive, being the real way that these groups' cases end up being resolved. If you look at the tags that the registry has done in the group's registry, you'll see that there's a DIS tag. And to me, that's really like the common theme of all of the group's cases that there are so far. And I know there's still, you know, this is still a smaller data set that's being developed out. That DIS tag refers to an officer having discipline during their case, like official discipline having been a part of it. To me, this sort of is like a, is this correlative or is this, you know, causation, like which came first? There, a lot of these cases, and I mean, Ken or Sam can speak to this more, these are cases where the discipline that the officer received is discipline that happened as a result of these cases, but there's some of them where that's not the case. You know, the Watts cases in Chicago that my colleague Josh has been litigating, folks involved in the scheme in those cases to plant drugs on people had discipline in their careers, but they got to keep doing their jobs. And I think this goes to the example that Deborah just gave too. You know, these are cases where the misconduct isn't unknown. You know, that's the group's exonerations that we have, cases where people did have some discipline at some point. And that to me speaks to the fact that these just may be the cases where it's possible to get these outcomes because there has been some official discipline. There's a recognition even by the system, you know, writ large, not just the defense side of this or the innocent side of this, that there's problems with how folks are doing their jobs. It doesn't have to be, you know, it's certainly not true, at least from my perspective, that these are the only cases where there are groups of people that deserve relief or group misconduct that deserves investigation. But it speaks to the importance of having those systems available for discipline and transparency in those systems so that folks can understand what officers' histories are and figure it out if there's more investigation that needs to be done. Those are ways I think that folks who have been involved in the civil side of this are trying to bring those methods and what people do on that end into trying to bring more justice up front and using the data that the group's registry has collected is a big part of that. So that's what I have, and I look forward to talking about this more with questions that people have.
So I want to first take a little prerogative here and ask a question. Oh, let's get Sam back up. Him on that screen again?
I think you just drag him.
Okay. You can unmute, Sam.
I have.
Oh, you have? Okay. So I want to ask a question and just get a little bit of a conversation started. You know, one of the motivations for this panel was to look at this new information that's been provided through the group's registry and learn more about how those cases evolve and how they're discovered. And one question that I have that's come up a lot talking about the registry cases, historically talking about the individual exonerations, one of the things that academics face and others face when thinking about how do we learn from this and apply it to the entire world of criminal justice, one of the critiques has always been like, well, these cases are really interesting, they're informative, but they're not representative of what the whole world of criminal justice looks like. One thing that kind of stands out with the group's data is that groups, you know, as Sam and Ken pointed out, the information coming out of those groups' cases and the distribution of offenses and the factors that are going on in those cases looks completely different than the individual database. And we're seeing this, you know, over 90% of them are drug cases, whereas the original database, a lot of focus on homicide and sex assault, which we talked about it some yesterday, and a lot of people know is a relatively small share of the world of criminal justice events and the kind of offenses that are going into the criminal justice system. So my question, and really to hear from anyone, is Well, it looks like we might be getting closer to something that's maybe more representative. What do we take away, or how do we think about the fact that we're now seeing this picture and realizing, you know, the frequency of officer misconduct, which is, looking at all these cases together, is the kind of number one most prominent factor in the cases. Are we starting to see a picture that resembles more closely to what the true world of wrongful arrest and prosecution may look like, and what that true distribution may look like? Are we getting closer by looking at these cases, or do we still have this kind of limitation based on the way cases make it into that registry?
I'll try to answer that if I can. Do you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so I'll say two things. First, we're maybe getting a step closer to representativeness in the sense that the cases we know about describe the universe of convictions of innocent people, but only a step. What we have here in the groups registry is primarily one cut of the type of injustices that occur in drug prosecutions. It's not the only thing we have, but that's the main thing we have. Those are cases that otherwise don't show up in the registry much for reasons we already mentioned. They're comparatively small cases, which people typically plead guilty even if they're innocent, get relatively short sentences, and they don't command the resources that it takes to get individual exonerations, which, as Tara and others can talk about, typically means thousands of hours, literally thousands of hours of work by lawyers, law students, paralegals, investigators, and other people to get one person exonerated, frequently after years, sometimes decades of work. Small cases don't get that attention. And as a result, for example, we have essentially no misdemeanors in the registry, except for a bunch of drug cases, not mostly these cases, but another drug case, which are the same sort of dam breaks we get all these individual cases showing up. So at the low end, we just don't see the cases. Because of these patterns of misconduct, which are a big deal as a pattern, once they become known, a lot of individual cases show up. And that shows us another aspect of the system, like we get to look through another window on the small range of things that are visible through that view. It's a second window, but it doesn't show us the whole landscape outside. But it does show us something big. I wanted to say something very quickly about what brings these groups to attention. And it's a variety of different things, but Ken can speak more about this. But one common thing for quite a few of them is what brings them to attention is federal prosecution of one of the officers involved, or more of the officers involved. So, for example, the Watts exonerations, which Tara, I think, probably knows a lot about from where we work in the Innocence, the exoneration project. They were well known to the community, the Ida B. Wells housing development community in which these took place. But it took first the conviction of two of the officers involved, and then years after that, years of lobbying and pressure by one of the exonerees, Ben Baker, one of the few who went to trial twice and got falsely convicted twice as a result of Sergeant Watts and his subordinates. He eventually got people to pay attention and got exoneration, and then a few others followed, and then the dam broke. But that initial step, which brought to attention, not to the people in the community, as Tara so rightly points out, they were complaining about this for years. Ben Baker himself, the reason he was prosecuted the second time is not that he was guilty, it's that he had the nerve, first, to go to trial instead of pleading guilty, and second, to file a complaint with the police and to contact the state's attorney's office, all of which was ignored and got him a second false conviction.
And I'll add to that. So we don't want to get to an ideal world where we're adding more to the group's registry. We want to prevent it. And so what are we doing in order to prevent it, at least in Maryland? We have pushed very, very hard in response to the Gun Trace Task Force to pass police transparency laws, and we passed Anton's law in 2018, making records public, part of the majority of states now that are making records public. And one of the things that we actually did in full disclosure, we get the records public, and then we use something called the Steptoe Report, which Michael Bromwich, who is a board member of the Quattrone Center, actually was hired by the city of Baltimore We are under consent decree to do an independent study of internal affairs investigations. It's fascinating. It's 600 pages. There's a really short executive summary, but basically saying internal affairs departments can be basically do horrible work inside of the department. And so prosecutors should be looking to allegations that are reported to make fair disclosure based on allegation, not based on outcome. And perhaps when prosecutors' offices start to disclose more based on the allegations against the officer and not the outcome, we will get to a more fair and just system. We got that in Baltimore. Just side note, the individual, the male attorney who you saw in the movie that I played the clip is now the newly elected state's attorney for the city of Baltimore. And so we're having to remind him of his defense attorney, civil attorney roots, and convince him to fully disclose everything based only on allegation, not just on outcome. And we're actually in the process of litigating for that and working for that right now. And it is very sad but true what Sam said, because when there's some legitimacy to our clients' complaints that have been being made for decades, and then all of a sudden a federal prosecutor decides the same thing our clients have been reporting for years, there is a moment of triumph in that and a moment of real sadness, because we've been saying the same thing for a very long time. Please listen. And so disclosure, the other slide that I had added is from Kyles versus Whitley from the United States Supreme Court that says a prosecutor worried about tacking too close to the wind should always disclose, err on the side of disclosure. So disclose as many records as possible, read as many internal affairs records as possible, and continue to lobby in your states for open transparency laws for police misconduct.
You know, I want to follow up on that, because one of the things that is, I'm going to try and sum up several of the questions. There have been a number of questions from the audience talking about what about prosecutor Brady lists, what's the role of CIUs, kind of thinking about that role of prosecutors. Some of the comments here, you know, Ken talked about how prosecutors have to be proactive rather than reactive in these cases. What Deb was just talking about was how important it is these allegations don't come up all of a sudden in 2009. They've been happening, just not in a way that's sort of procedurally recognized. And so what observations have there been? Are we seeing any movement or change in the attitudes of prosecutors or the policies of prosecutors to incorporate some of this information and to sort of rethink or handle these cases differently? Is there change on that front happening yet, where, you know, instead of just being held to these very sort of close, arbitrary dates of discovery, but rather sort of having this more holistic approach to what is now becoming clearer and clearer as a sort of continuous and persistent issue in these cases that, as has been discussed here, this corrupts good arrests as much as it does bad arrests. You know, and when you have these bad officers, some of those bad officers made otherwise good arrests that are now, you know, also subject to this criticism. So have you, anyone seen any changes or have thoughts on where we are now versus just a few years ago, or how does that sit today?
That's my life's work. So as a director of special, this is what I do every day, is we walk around basically trying to educate prosecutors. This is your obligation. Judges, you ought to take it seriously. And defense attorneys also, on how to look for this information in your cases. And so attitudes, we're moving a mountain very, very slowly, at least in the state of Maryland, on how we deal with this issue. And we ultimately will need to make this a law, because we are at the whim of prosecutors as they ebb and flow on fairness and strong on crime statistics. And it is a, this prosecutors, it just rises and falls with the tide based on how important it is and how much they want to focus on this versus how much they want to focus on, you know, preventing crime. And so we have to lobby constantly for consistent disclosure, consistent importance on this. And actually, probably one of the things, the Brady lists, we collect data on Brady violations. What we're going to do with it, I don't know. Whoever has a great idea on how to continue to make this part of the conversation. And I would say prosecutors should have defense attorneys come to every conference, because we're gonna tell you what you don't wanna hear, probably more so than a prosecutor might tell you. And this kind of dialogue is actually helpful, because we're preaching to the choir at defense conferences. So it is happening. We just have to constantly work with the ebbing and the flowing. And in other, like for example, we passed transparency laws in Maryland, and then the next year you have to deal with all the pushback. We have PIA request to get now public police misconduct records across the state of Maryland, and we also have a fee request from only one jurisdiction of Montgomery County has asked for us for $1 million in fees in order to produce those records. And that's just one example. Other jurisdictions are asking for over $320,000 to produce the records. So we're just going forwards and backwards, which I think is what they found in other jurisdictions where the same thing in New Orleans and Chicago, you go back and forth depending on the mood of the day.
Can I add something to
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely.
I mean, to me, there's really two issues here. One is, can we reach some collective agreement that there's a problem here that needs to be solved, which is what the group's registry or the registry more generally is trying to identify? Like, can we agree that there's misconduct that's creating, at minimum, you know, real concerns about the veracity of these convictions and the trustworthiness of our system? And if we get to that agreement in some cases, we need to get to that agreement and more, but let's get to some agreement. The second issue is, whose problem is that to solve? You know, who feels like it's their obligation to step in and fix it? Are we thinking that, you know, every jurisdiction has a Deborah whose office is going to go to these extreme lengths to, like, raise the issue and bring these cases? Are we just relying on, you know, Innocence Projects or the private bar to bring the cases forward where they think they can help folks' convictions get vacated? Or does someone in government feel like it's actually their responsibility to do something proactively about these cases? And I think that's what the registry folks talked about before, you know, proactive prosecutors being such a key role in that. And to me, that can and has come from CIUs in certain places. It can come from prosecutors' offices, even where there's not a CIU, but where someone feels like they have the time, the mandate, the resources to do some kind of comprehensive investigation, because that's what these cases require. Again, that could come from law enforcement if they wanted to, could come from federal prosecutors, it could come from anyone, but who feels like it's their responsibility? That's really the question.
I will just say, in full disclosure, CIU units are not perfect. Our CIU unit refused to look at the case that I just read you the order from. And so now the CIU unit who refused to review it is now dealing with a Brady violation on paper for a veteran homicide prosecutor. So I don't know always that a CIU unit who knows the prosecutor has the ability to objectively look at the facts and evaluate. So it should it be a neutral party, or should we have more definitive laws, or should we take it outside of either office altogether? I don't know, but it's not a perfect system yet.
Well, I guess that kind of, we obviously do a lot of work with this, with CIU units around the country, and I think it's important to point out that there are a number of constraints on the kinds of cases that they look at, and they have to put in place sort of filtering mechanisms for how they review those cases. And for many of the reasons that we've talked about, these cases, you know, even talking about how they go into the registry, it takes a while to sort of think about the dimensions of these cases and sort of fit them into our traditional bins of cases with these kinds of procedural problems, and how do you define an exoneration. And that's something that's challenging for everybody in the system, and it's challenging for prosecutor offices that also have, you know, actual innocence claims versus, you know, claims involving these officers and these kinds of issues. So, you know, I guess the question that flows from that is, How can we think about sort of collecting better information that allows those stakeholders and those policymakers to kind of make those decisions and sort of identify where the parameters, how the parameters need to be adjusted? Because we're constantly dealing with a serial evolution of fixed parameters. So there's always things that are outside those borders, and it's very hard to get a lot of these systems to move more quickly. And you know, the National Registry, while it has this great information, it's still limited. They have information internally about police misconduct and kind of on a national scale from coding these cases, but obviously the mission of the National Registry is to create that registry within those confines, and then all these individual systems and offices have similar sort of limited mission. So what are the sort of answers to that, I suppose, in terms of creating national level information so that jurisdictions can understand trends and look at these both from outcomes, which we've talked about are limited in other ways, but also to track the things that they do know internally. The Brady List officers, the other things that they're hearing about. Defender offices, too, have an obligation here to, like, find a way to track their information and make it available in some way that obviously doesn't violate all the confidentiality and things that are in place there. So what does all this teach us about ways to possibly increase the level of information about these cases that may be helpful to make some of the shifts that we're talking about?
Sounds like another symposium to me. I don't
know. Oh, yeah, Sam?
I'm not going to answer the question, but I'm going to do what I often do in this joke, which is add another level of skepticism about what we know. We collect information on misconduct and wrote a long report on it and try to emphasize misconduct by its nature is concealed. And we only know about the misconduct that's discovered, which would typically be misconduct that's A, more visible, and B, less intelligent. The type of misconduct we see here in group exonerations, overwhelmingly in drug cases, is probably a type of misconduct that is very common in drug cases in a different way, as an individual form of misconduct by individual officers, only do it occasionally. But what we find out about are cases that are typically, not all, but typically, literally, big enough to become federal cases. If an officer in a small town in Pennsylvania who does occasional drug busts periodically says, you know, I'm just going to bust this guy and plant drugs on him, and does that 20 times in his career, you know, 30 times in her career, 5 times a year, doesn't talk to much to many other officers about it, we will never hear about it. We will never know about it. It will be too small. The defendant may complain and tell his attorney or her attorney, I was innocent. The attorney will say, yeah, you may well be, but here's the deal, when you don't want to go to trial because you'll be convicted. And we will never hear about it. We hear about the cases that involve numerous defendants and severe misconduct, and only some of those. We probably don't hear about the most. We have no group exonerations from New York City. Is this because patterns like this have never occurred in any of the 5 boroughs of New York City? I don't believe that recipe. And we certainly don't know about most cases where it's not a big group, but just a few cases by an individual officer. And those probably are the great majority. The reason I mention this is to once again point out the limit of what we can know, even doing the extremely good work, which I'm very proud of, people like Ken and Maury and our other staff doing, and the editors supervising it as we've been doing now for 12 years. That gets to the second thing, what to do about group exonerations? Now, decriminalize drugs, stop this. I mean, this is an aspect of the war on drugs and not necessarily the worst. Now, mass incarceration of people of color is probably the, who may be guilty technically, maybe the worst part of it, but the answer to this one is really simple, because it's an aspect of a terrible social problem we've generated for no reason, and one that we will never know the extent of, given the type of information we have about how our criminal justice system operates.
Well, thank you very much for that. On that positive, positive note, I want to extend a sincere thanks to the panel. Thank you so much. I thought for sure we could solve this problem in 90 minutes, but apparently we still have a little bit more work to do. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Nice job.